Good morning, and I would like to welcome everyone to this, the seventh meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. I would remind our virtual members to place an R in the chat function on BlueJeans if they would like to come in on any of the issues. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. The first item is whether the committee will agree to take agenda item five and six in private. Agenda item 5 is correspondence that we've received from the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, and agenda item 6 is for us to consider our approach to the report on the Citizens' Assembly. Do members agree to take these items in private? Agreed. I'm grateful for that. Our next agenda item is to deal with the Scottish Local Government Elections Candidacy Rights of Foreign Nationals Bill, and joining us today are George Adam, MSP, Minister for Parliamentary Business, Ian Hockenhall, Elections Bill Team Leader, and David McLennan, who's the Solicitor for the Government. I'd like to welcome you this morning, gentlemen. And can I invite you, Minister, to make a short opening speech with regard to the bill?
Yes, thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone on the committee. I'm grateful for the opportunity to be here today to discuss the Scottish Local Government Elections Candidacy Rights of Foreign Nationals Bill. This bill seeks to ensure compliance with treaties that the UK government has agreed in relation to voting and candidacy rights in the local government elections. These treaties have been agreed with Portugal, Luxembourg, Spain and Poland. At present, all foreign nationals with any form of leave to remain in the United Kingdom can vote in a Scottish local government election. But candidacy rights are limited to those with indefinite leave to remain or pre-settled status. We anticipate that most EU nationals currently resident in Scotland already have candidacy rights. The bill is tightly focused upon the treaties that I've mentioned. While our law on voting rights already complies with the treaties, this bill is needed to ensure compliance in relation to candidacy rights. It will do this by extending candidacy rights to any nationals of Portugal, Luxembourg, Spain and Poland who have a limited form of leave to remain in the United Kingdom. The government's shared policy programme last autumn undertook to develop legislation on electoral reform to enable more people to stand as candidates at Scottish Parliament and local government elections. I have previously outlined to the committee my intention to consult later this year on a number of electoral reform proposals, and I expect that consultation to consider issues surrounding a wider expansion of candidacy rights. For example, all foreign nationals with limited leave to remain or to 16 and 17-year-olds. I look forward to discussing this bill with the committee, and I'm completely happy to answer any questions members have.
Thank you very much, Minister. Very, very brave offer. If I can just kick off with a couple of general questions with regard to the bill. The reference is in essence made to treaties that exist between the UK government and other national countries around Europe. And some of those treaties aren't yet in force. Are you concerned that there may be a situation where this bill will come into force, but actually the treaty itself won't be in force, thus triggering the rights? Or do you have confidence that, which I'm given to understand, the UK government are waiting for alignment from across the four nations here before actually finalising the treaties?
Yes, as many of the answers I'll probably give you today will be a UK government problem and situation to deal with. Are there some concerns over these kind of things? There's always concerns over there might be a situation where someone might not be able to put themselves forward as the candidate's rights. But I think at the end of the day, the important thing for us to remember is that we have the opportunity in this bill where we will be able to, if the UK does change the treaty, then we will be able to use a statutory instrument to make sure we can follow suit as well. Is there a chance that someone might have difficulty in being a candidate in the future going through that? There might be, but it would be a small percentage. I think if you look at the percentage of the number of us that put our names compared to the general population forward for electoral office, and then you take the numbers of the individuals that this bill will actually do, it's a small minority. And I'm not saying it wouldn't happen, but it's unlikely, and if it did happen, it would be an extreme case.
So you still have confidence that using this bill as the vehicle for delivery is the right way to go? That's very helpful. One of the aspects that's been raised in looking at this bill is in relation to who's responsible for ensuring that the candidate can lawfully stand. And at the minute, my understanding is that in the election process, an individual would come forward, and the authority that the returning officer for an area requires is the declaration that that candidate will sign to say that they can stand as a candidate. Are you happy with that process going forward? And if I can perhaps extend that slightly, is that something that you might be looking at with regard to the election bill that I know is being anticipated towards the end of this session?
I'll take the second question first, because basically the election bill, my officials will be loving me, because every time I appear in committee, I add to it. Effectively, I think Ian's already said that it's getting a lot larger than what it was previously. But I think it's important that we do look at all of these options with regards to the consultation that we're putting forward, and to just make sure that when we do come with our elections bill in a number of years' time, then we have we've got something robust there that we can use in the future. With regards to, what was your first question again?
In essence, at the moment, the responsibility about whether or not a candidate can stand, in essence, rests with the candidate who signs a declaration, and the returning officer relies on that declaration to say that the candidate can go forward. And I'm just wondering whether you have confidence in that system.
Currently, sorry to interrupt, Convener.
No.
Currently, that's a norm for us all for putting our names forward, and effectively that would be the process. And I'm comfortable with it. Again, to the extent that it will, with all the checks and balances that local authorities do when it comes to people putting their name forward for election, that we should be in a safe place with that. But as I've said when I answered your second question first, that's maybe something we can look at if people do have issues with it. You know, we need to investigate that to see if that is a problem as such.
I think one of the challenges, and I raise it in relation to this bill, is that obviously it's more likely post an election result that perhaps that position could become apparent, and it's whether or not, given that we are talking about very small numbers of individuals, but still they are being given the right to stand in this case under certain circumstances, whether or not that should be just looked at beforehand, or whether you're reassured with confidence that that review can wait further down the line.
You're second.
Yeah. Thank you. My final question in relation to this is whether or not you have any concerns that nationals from the same country who are resident here in Scotland will actually have different candidacy rights entirely dependent on their immigration status. Is that something that concerns you?
Again, it's something that's concerning, but again, it's down to the UK government and how that individual's rights are and their place within the country at that stage. So, yes, it's one of these things that is really out with the scope of my hands and more to do with colleagues in the UK government.
Thank you for that. Tess, can I hand over to you?
Yes. So in relation to data for local authorities, do you think that there are areas that are more likely to be affected because of a greater number of foreign nationals?
I think, again, Tess, when you look at the numbers that we're looking at, it's a small number of people. So if I look at it logically, you would probably say that most people would go into the main urban settlements in Scotland, and as such, they would be in a position where they could probably cope with the demand that would be. You know, so I would say on the whole, but with regards to the actual data, it's very difficult for us to have the data, because when someone comes into the country, they effectively, and they can move as they like, they might turn up in Glasgow and end up working in Birmingham or London, you know, or living and working in Birmingham and London. So we don't tend to keep data on that. But just to give you total clarity in your answer, I'll bring in Ian, because Ian might be able to give us some kind of detail on what data we do hold.
Good morning. We identified two sources of data in the policy memorandum for the bill, one on nationality, so a snapshot of nationality by people resident in Scotland. Another one was applications for settled status. So the first table is purely based on Scotland. Rather frustratingly, when you look at it, you see for England and Wales, there's local government breakdown, but just for Scotland, it's just one entry and it's 5 million people. But for the settled status information, there is local government breakdown, local authority breakdown by Scotland to that. So we could highlight that to the committee by email or send that over, that link, if that would be useful.
Can I just summarise? So just to summarise, Minister, and is not yet, but maybe in future we'll have a better indication of where foreign nationals will reside and if there's issues for local authorities.
The answer would be balanced in so much in relation to this actual bill. The limited number of people who it will involve. We've got to remember that when we're talking about everything in this bill. But with regards to the data, Ian, if you want to answer that side.
Yes, I think it's just the data we have is only a snapshot, frozen in time. So it tells us where people were, say, a year and a half ago, and they may have all moved since then. So it is purely indicative, I think.
Test where someone effectively has come into Glasgow and then works in Aberdeen, get a job in Aberdeen, or go to university or whatever in somewhere else. So it's kind of difficult. It happens in normal life.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tess. Bob, can I hand over to you?
Morning, Minister. Just a couple of brief questions this morning. My understanding is this bill will mean that nationals of Luxembourg, Poland, Portugal and Spain would qualify for candidacy rights under Schedule 6A. Nationals, and that's the components within the bill, and that's based in UK. A UK treaty has been signed, having been signed, or likely to be signed imminently in the future. So it does beg the question, I suppose, whether the UK government has indicated that treaties conferring reciprocal candidacy rights are likely to be signed with any other EU countries or any other countries at all, actually. And in that case, would this bill still be able to cope with our obligations in relation to any new treaties that might be signed?
So hopefully I'm getting Mr. Dorris right or Bob right in this situation where we're saying if we expand, if the UK government expanded the list of countries, then as I mentioned earlier on, we would have the opportunity as a statutory instrument to be able to change and include any new treaties that are included in it.
Right, so that's fine. So this bill is fit for purpose to cope with that as things stand then?
Yep,
thank you. I wonder, I mean, treaties get signed, they also fall into abeyance, or, you know, countries may withdraw from treaties. So it's reasonable to ask whether it's open for ministers of Scottish Government to continue to extend such candidacy rights to Schedule 6A nationals, even when a treaty comes to an end by not exercising the powers in paragraph 3 of Schedule 6A. So if the UK government was to renege, the wrong expression, Minister, but if they were to withdraw from a treaty, would the Scottish government be keen to ensure that those candidacy rights were not lost, and are there provisions within this bill to make sure that can happen?
Well, I believe no matter how keen I or other ministers would be for that to remain the case, the difficulty would be that this bill would have difficulty doing that, in so much as it's up to the UK government and for them to actually do the treaties. And just as if they create a new treaty, it would be impossible for us to actually just continue with that country if the UK should decide that country and that treaty was no longer anymore.
Right. So just for my clarity then, if Portugal is one of the countries mentioned, so Portuguese nationals in Scotland and across the UK, of course, some small number, we understand, will have additional rights to stand as a candidate in UK elections, and this bill enables that to happen. If that treaty was to be reneged on or be withdrawn from the UK government, there's nothing in this legislation that would allow you to continue to extend those candidacy rights to Portuguese nationals in Scotland. We would have to withdraw them, or can we sustain those candidacy rights?
I feel I've already answered that, but just to make you feel totally happy with the answer, Bob, I will ask Ian to confirm what I've just said a minute ago.
sorry, I'm clogged up today. This bill is very much focused on the treaties, so we've taken the view in drafting it that it should only be a reflection of the treaty arrangements. So the expectation is that if a treaty is cancelled, then the obligation would be to withdraw those rights, regardless of the policy preference. The reason that there's a slight difference in terminology in the wording of the bill, it talks about adding countries, it says must, and when it talks about removing countries, it says may. But that is not intended to show a discretion. It's merely a transitional thing to ensure that if a treaty is cancelled during an election campaign, we can manage it in such a way as to not disrupt people who've already nominated themselves and that sort of thing. It's not intended to give a discretion to allow the treaty the rights to continue despite the treaty being cancelled.
Okay, that is very helpful. And Minister, that does give the clarity I was looking for. So treaty signed, rights extended, treaties withdrawn, rights are withdrawn. So my final question, I suppose, would be this ever-increasing elections bill that will be consulted over the Scottish Government. I would hope that this would extend candidacy rights across all EU nationals in similar situations, irrespective of these four treaties. Can you give us any idea of the timing around the elections bill? I mean, every time we ask for something to be added, I suppose it gets delayed further, but there we are.
We're currently working on the consultation at the moment, and as I mentioned earlier, I'm making my officials work harder because I keep adding to it every time. So I do believe that we're going to probably look towards that towards the end of this year, or
possibly earlier, depending on how we...
Yeah, depending I don't add anything further to it. So it's all down to the discipline of the Minister. So basically, it should be towards the end of the year, maybe sooner. We should have the consultation, and then we can move on. As with everything else, it will all be about getting time in the programme for government, which year we manage to get this in, but it will definitely be part of this session's programme.
That's helpful, Minister. Convener, no further questions. I'm just minded to note that perhaps the discipline of this committee as well, given additional asks that may come forward from us in relation to adding to that consultation, which you keep having to redraft before you publish it. But no further questions, Convener.
Thank you, Bob. I'm not sure we're asking. We've merely pointed out areas where, in particular, I think of consultation, it may be useful, and indeed with data. Just really to clarify one point for the purposes of the evidence, this Act purely relates to the Scottish local government elections and in no way affects national elections. That's right, isn't it? Very grateful for that.
Yeah.
Edward, I think you wanted to come in at this stage.
Yep, thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Just to say at this stage, not treaties are always between multiple parties, not one party. So I think the Deputy Convener may have been at error by saying that if the UK government renege, it could be the other side that decide to pull out of the treaty, not just the UK government. Minister, if I could just ask you, the DPLR wrote you a letter on the 1st of March regarding the whole issue that we're discussing at the moment about May powers and duties. Will you be responding to that letter shortly, and will we be in a position to see that response, because we were copied in the response, the original letter from the DPLR committee?
The answer will be brief, Mr. Mountain, and it'll be yes and yes.
Okay, perfect. So when you're responding to that letter, you will be saying that it is a duty to remove, and it's not just going to be a policy decision to keep people on the list. If they pull out, if the treaty stops, that then ends the agreement.
I may have misunderstood your question. I was saying yes, you will get a copy of the letter. Yes, I will be doing it timorously, and yes, you will be getting a copy of the letter. With regards to, are you talking about what the Deputy Convener brought up earlier on about?
I am indeed, which is the whole point of the letter, which no doubt you will have read.
Yep,
and understood.
No problem. I quite, with regards to that, it would be a case of exactly what I said to the Deputy Convener. Should, regardless of who is the individual or the nation that did pull out of it, it will be us that we will follow suit in this Parliament.
Okay, thank you very much, Minister. That's my only question, you'll be pleased to know.
Thank you, Edward. And again, just for the purposes of clarification, the letter from Stuart McMillan that was dated the 1st of March, this is where I put your, civil servants on the spot, they've requested an answer by the 8th of March. Will that be achievable?
I will just double check with my officials.
Yes.
Yes, it will be.
Thank you very much for that confirmation. Colette, can I turn to you?
Yep. Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I wanted to sort of touch upon the financial implications there. The financial memorandum noted that there could be a cost implication associated with the bill for the local authorities. And I'm just wondering whether you're open to a continued dialogue with local authorities on the matter of funding for elections, particularly if there is a greater need for by-elections, and knowing that by-elections it come to the region of about £50,000. So if there is by-elections, that, you know, that there is an anticipated, because of some individuals having limited time, really, in terms of to remain.
Yeah, Colette, and I'm sorry if I'm sound if I repeat myself over and over again, but again, it goes down to the limited number of individuals that will be. Well, you look at it in this, you look at the general population, and you look at how many of us put our name forward. Now, take that to a part of the community that we're talking about here, who there'll be even limited number of them that will go forward. And should there be any discrepancies and there'll be a by-election because of someone's put their name forward and they shouldn't have been the election, then it's going to be such a tiny amount, and the odds. I'm not saying it's impossible, but the odds are. If I was a betting man, you know, I wouldn't be betting on the chances of that happening. But I'm not saying it couldn't happen. In extreme cases, it could. But the numbers are such that it would be almost, very few. So on the whole, if you compare it to by-elections that currently happen in local authorities, I don't think it would change the number. To a greater degree, but to give you even further detail and make you feel even better, I'll bring in Ian again.
I think one of the one of the reasons that the franchise legislation in 2020 didn't extend candidacy rights further was the concern that if someone were elected with limited leave, say 2.5 years, and that expired during their term of office, then you would be obliged to resign and you'd have a by-election. So it is a theoretical possibility that this bill will be allowing people with limited leave to become councillors if they want to. But as the Minister says, the numbers must be very small. They would have to want to do it. They would have to win the election. They would have to meet the normal tests for standing for local government election, which is a connection of some sort, employment or residence to that community. And they would be within this group of not having settled status or pre-settled status who are qualified regardless and have long-lasting leave. So they would have to be in this group of having limited leave and be from these four countries. So and the population figures for those four countries, they're in the thousands, they're not high in Scotland. So we think that means that the chances must be quite low, but we can't be ruled out, which is why we put the information in the financial memorandum.
So just quickly on that, so obviously the implication being as well that there's, you know, a vacancy arising more than 6 months. So being a local councillor within South Lanarkshire, you know, you have to attend meetings. So if you've not attended any particular meeting, whether it be full council within 6 months, is there scope there within the bill to maybe amend that?
And so to modify the existing law on,
yeah,
on that? Jumped in.
I was going to say that is what it is, that would stay the same, you know, because that's the role of being a local councillor. Having been a councillor myself, and you know, actually, half of me thinks, and you'll agree with me, Colette, why would somebody want to actually be a councillor? Because it's a hard job for anyone to do, you know. It's you're literally in the front line of politics, but any individual... I think the important part of this bill is the enabling part of it. If someone does want to do that and does want to represent their community, and in some cases, these communities that are maybe kind of small hubs throughout the country, it gives them that opportunity, but doesn't take away the fact that, as both you and I and others know and hear, it's a difficult job and you're in the front line of politics. You're literally just down the street from many of the individuals that you're representing.
Absolutely. It's a vocation, definitely. That's what I keep telling myself anyway. Uh-huh. So, no, thanks very much. I have no further questions.
I used to have a colleague, Councillor Jim Mitchell, councillor in the SNP for 35 years in Renfrewshire, and he used to say at that time it was something like 3% of the population actually get involved in politics, and then we spend the rest of the time just falling out with each other and shouting at each other. He says, why?
Thank you, Colette. I suppose just to follow on, given we are talking such tiny, tiny potential numbers, but actually the cost that falls on a local authority of a by-election is quite high. Would it not be possible, I realise not necessarily through this bill, but as a piece of open evidence and undertaking for the government, not to consider giving financial support to local authorities in this very, very particular circumstances where, as you say, it is unlikely to occur, but in itself, because it is so unlikely to occur, could cause financial challenges for a local authority if it comes about?
My answer to that, convener, would be the fact that, you know, it would be very, I'd be very surprised if over the piece we ended up with a record amount of by-elections in local authorities, and it was in such a case that it was causing financial problems for said authority. Is it something, should that, if that ever did happen, would it be something we'd have a watching brief on and possibly look at? Yes, that would be the case. But I really find it difficult for to see that we would end up with such a mass of it'd be interesting if I actually checked to see how many by-elections on average there are in over a period of the whole period, and I'll endeavour to check that myself and get back to the committee on that detail. But on the whole, I would think it would I'd be very surprised, but if that did happen, then it would be something I would be keeping an eye on myself.
So could it be phrased as, if it occurs, a reasonable request wouldn't be unreasonably refused?
Indeed. If we ended up in a place that I don't think we're going to end up.
Absolutely, but I think that's why it may be helpful to examine that, because it is a very unlikely event. But it is an event that rests completely out with the local authority with regards to why someone was a candidate at one stage, but then subsequently couldn't occur. I'm grateful for that. Tess, do you want to follow up?
No, I'm good, thank you.
Are you all right with that? Yeah. Any other questions? I have one last question, which really has come out from the evidence that we've heard today, which goes to the policy memorandum, which obviously sits along with the bill. And when we look towards the end, the various certifications that are made, one relates to island communities where it's been stated that there's no disproportionate effect on island communities being envisaged. My question really relates to what we've heard in respect of the data. Are you confident with that reassurance, given the different level of confidence there is actually over how far this extends and who it catches to? Because I think of some island communities, and indeed, you know, island communities that have been incredibly open to people moving to the islands from, you know, not just across the United Kingdom, but across the European Union. Really, I'm asking for your confidence that that statement is still correct.
I am confident that the statement is still correct. And also, when again, I don't want to labour the point, but when we look at it, I agree with you, there has been many island communities who have embraced people from other parts of the world. But again, when we look at the numbers, I've got a colleague that always says, always look at the numbers, George. But if you look at the numbers, most people that come to start a new life will be in our main urban population, and that will be our main cities that they will be probably be. But I take it on board, but I do actually, I'm still okay with everything as is.
That's excellent. There being no further questions, can I thank you, Minister, and those that attend with you for your evidence today. We'll consider this matter later.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Could I now suspend this meeting? Good morning, and I reconvene this meeting. And our third item for the committee is to consider an application for the recognition of a proposed cross-party group on the wood panel industry. And I'm going to welcome Fergus Ewing, MSP, to this meeting. And Fergus is the proposed convener if the proposed CPG is granted accreditation. Good morning, Fergus. Apologies, Fergus, we're not hearing you at the minute.
Is that better? Good morning.
We can now hear you. Good morning, Fergus. Could I hand over to you to introduce the CPG?
Well, thank you very much, convener and members, for your time this morning. The cross-party group on the wood panel industry will consider the interests of this important sector, a sector that's very important to the economy of Scotland. There are three main wood panel manufacturers in the UK, namely Norbord, Egger and Kronospan. And these three companies are the constituent members of the Wood Panel Industries Federation, the WPIF, and they operate across six sites located in England, Scotland and Wales. Significantly, three of these sites are in Scotland: Norbord near Inverness, Norbord at Cowie, and Egger at Barony. And these member companies operate a business-to-business interface supplying some of the UK's biggest brands, including B&Q, Jewson, Wickes and Howdens, to name but a few. Manufactured wood-based and panel products as chipboard, oriented strand board and medium-density fibre board can be identified in virtually every home, office and shop and are extensively used in the construction, furniture making, packaging and transportation industries. The wood panel industry makes a significant contribution to the UK economy and is disproportionately important to Scotland due to half of the industry being located here. Wood panel manufacturers play an important role in the Scottish economy, helping to support regional employment and supply local and local supply chains. Excuse me. In 2018, the average salary of those employed in the industry was £36,235, and the industry has a strong track record of investing in local communities, for example, through successful apprenticeship schemes. Forestry investment is key to ensuring the sustainable growth of the industry. The UK government has set a target for planting 30,000 hectares a year by 2024, with England committed to delivering 7,000 hectares, Wales expecting to deliver up to 4,000 hectares per annum. Scotland is very much leading the way in terms of ambition, with our own target to plant 18,000 hectares per annum. One of the key purposes of this group will be, convener, to discuss and explore the wood security challenge and to encourage England and Wales to raise their ambitions for tree planting. The sector is working hard to play its role in contributing to net zero aims through the decarbonising of manufacturing processes and role of wood panelling products in carbon sequestration. This will be another key area for the group to examine. The group intends to work closely with the Wood Panel Industries Federation in order to gain a detailed understanding of the challenges facing the sector. The WPIF will act as the group's secretariat, ensuring a clear link with industry partners. At the group's initial meeting, there was cross-party attendance from members across Scotland. Alongside myself, as a proposed convener, we have two elected deputy conveners, namely Stephen Kerr, MSP Conservative, and Colin Smith, MSP Labour. The next step for the group will be to agree our policy priorities. We will do this in consultation with WPIF. Our intention will be to draw up policy recommendations to Scottish Government in order to inform our engagement with Scottish Government ministers. At Westminster, there is already, convener, an all-party parliamentary group for the wood panel industry, and we will also look for opportunities to work with them in order to influence the UK government as well. Many thanks for the opportunity to set out this brief description of this very important industry to Scotland.
Thank you very much for that. Are there any questions from the committee? Tess?
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Thank you, Fergus. Just two questions, if I may. What's your view as convener of the current threats facing the industry? Just the high level.
Well, I would say that the industry has been doing pretty well. It has been an industry where there has been very substantial investment. And that means, for example, that the Norbord plant, which is in my constituency, is one of the most modern in the whole of Europe, and thereby able to operate very efficiently in terms of the modern plant that has recently been installed there, with an investment well in excess of £100 million. So I would say that my understanding is that the industry has been doing fairly well of late, and the challenges, to answer your question, facing it, I would say, are the risk of continuing high energy costs, as it obviously is a fairly energy intensive exercise. In addition to that, I think labour shortages in some areas are a challenge for many employers, as members will appreciate. I guess on a wider macro stage, the companies do business primarily in the UK, but also have an interest in purchasing materials and doing business with mainland Europe. And obviously we know that currently there's considerable uncertainty facing the geopolitical situation there.
Just got one more question, if I may, Fergus. So will he be touching upon a very delicate issue of tree planting on arable land?
Well, I think we will look at the issue from the perspective of the industry. And the perspective of the industry is that they require a continuous, reliable supply of raw material, namely timber of a certain quality. And the reason, Tess, why we have these plants in Scotland is that they are located in areas which are close to areas of large afforestation of commercial species. I know that because I was formerly forestry minister, that the in consideration of applications for consent for planting of trees, there is a kind of presumption, I think, which is that prime arable land should not be deployed for tree planting. That issue is a matter for the Scottish Government relevant ministers concerned. But I do know also that there is ample scope in Scotland for more afforestation. But plainly, the forestry standards, which were developed in the mid-1990s, are applicable here to prevent, if you like, the mistakes that were made in the 80s when trees were planted in heavy peat on very steep land, which is inaccessible for felling or for even maintaining. So, you know, I think that the system of making sure that the right tree is planted in the right place is a very sound and mature and developed one in Scotland. I think that the group will look very closely at how working together with the farmers, crofters, land managers, landowners, agents, contractors, the nurseries, and indeed the colleges, we can ensure that the targets are met. And it's very important, because only if the industry has this continuous steady supply of commercial species wood and timber, will they be able to continue to grow. And by continuing to grow, of course, they increasingly will be building new houses made of wood rather than concrete or brick. And I think, no expert, but I think that must be good news for net zero and for environmental aims, and something that I think many people in Scotland would like to see, although we are a wee bit further ahead in Scotland in the use of wood for house construction. So I think our main focus initially will be to look at the issue of how can the Scottish Government best meet its target of 18,000 hectares, but within that, to make sure that there is a sufficient supply of commercial species in order to continue to provide the feedstock for this very important sector of the economy. And I'm sure that the businesses involved will be very grateful for the member's interest, the member's own interest. I hope that she may and others may consider joining the group. Obviously, we would like more people to come along. And it is really a modern success story in Scotland. And I think it's fitting, therefore, convener, that it should be the subject of more detailed parliamentary work with the object of enabling it to achieve even more.
Thank you, Fergus, and thank you, Tess. Bob, I understand that you have a question.
You do, convener. Good morning, Fergus. I have to admit that I am no expert, as will soon become apparent, in the wood panel industry in Scotland, but I was looking at the paper submitted, and it did seem slightly unusual, because I don't know the sector, that when you list the organisations involved in the cross-party group, it says the Wood Panel Industry Federation and Invicta Public Affairs, and normally cross-party groups, a whole host of organisations and stakeholders come forward and are part of the cross-party group, and that does seem quite limited. And I think you said, Fergus, that there are three main wood panel manufacturers in the UK who are also based in Scotland, and they are the key stakeholders within the Wood Panel Industries Federation. But what I was interested to know is, within the wood panel industry, are there other players? Are there maybe smaller manufacturers that might have a voice, that might take a different perspective on things? I have no idea where large timber merchants fit into this. So any more information you can provide would be really welcome. And so I'll roll my two questions together, convener, for time constraints. So anything you can say on that would be really helpful. But also, is there a role, because I was listening to you I answer some questions there. Most consumers, most Scots, don't think about the supply and sustainability of wood. We don't think about the economic contribution or the job creation that it involves, and we don't think about the employment. So is there a wider mission there to say more for weegees like myself who just pitch up and buy their furniture and the like, to learn more about the sector more generally and the contribution it makes to the economy?
Well, I think that last point about spreading awareness and knowledge of the sector in Scotland in general is a very well made, and that has certainly been one that's already been put and discussed in the initial discussions we've had on the proposed cross-party group at our first meeting. And, you know, I think if more people were aware, for example, that Sitka spruce, a species that's much maligned in Scotland, actually is an invaluable building material for the houses that everybody knows we need, then perhaps I think people's views may warm to this excellent species. I'm sure Mr. Mountain will well know, it is well suited to being planted in the Scottish temperate climate, and its qualities for construction use are of a high standard, making it an invaluable part of the forestry composition in Scotland. And therefore, I think the group it can get the message across that that as well as being good for the planet, forestry is also a vital source material. Commercial species are a vital source material for the construction sector, and weaning us away from brick and concrete block housing to timber housing. And of course, in continental Europe, Scandinavia, they're miles ahead of us in the use of wood. The second question, I think, was, you know, tell us a little bit more about the sector. Well, the panel product sector is part of the larger sort of commercial timber sector in Scotland, and they are represented by a trade body, Confor, and they're not part of this group, but obviously we will work closely with them, and they would include companies such as BSW, James Jones, Glennons, Gordons in my constituency. You asked also if there were smaller panel products manufacturers. To my knowledge, there aren't, and the reason is that it's in order to produce panel products, you do require very substantial capital investment. you can't really do it on a small scale. For it to work, it has to be on a large scale. And I did mention the scale of the investment that Norbord have made in Dalcross, well in excess of £100 million. There are, of course, an important supply chain. They're important for the whole rural economy because they support tree planting, tree growing. They support the nurseries. So they're part of part of the overall timber sector in Scotland, which I think is moving from being kind of Cinderella in the economy to becoming more centre stage, perhaps largely for environmental reasons now, but also because of the contribution they make to construction and areas like furniture making and specialist applications. So I hope that we will make sure, as Mr. Doris has perhaps implied, that we bring on board others who have something to contribute to the discussion. For example, firms that are involved commercial firms that are involved in the business of processing applications for forestry consent. I think their commercial knowledge will be very useful to inform the debate about how we make sure there's a sufficient supply of commercial timber as a proportion of that 18,000 hectares per annum, and to build up a consensus that there needs to be, and I think there is, but there needs to be a further stability and a long-term approach to forestry. Because if you think about it, when you plant a tree, there's no income for 30 or 40 years. That sets it apart from many other industries. It's a long-term business. And, you know, Norbord, Egger and Kronospan wouldn't be in Scotland if it wasn't for the fact that we have been able to satisfy them that we are aware of their needs for a long-term, secure, continuous planting of commercial species in Scotland.
Very helpful, Mr. Ewing. No further questions, Convener.
Thank you, Bob, and thank you, Fergus. Are there any other questions from in the room? No. Can I thank you for attending today, Fergus? The committee will consider whether to approve the application for recognition at agenda item 4, and the clerks will inform you of that decision thereafter. But can I thank you for your presentation today and answering the wide and varied questions on it? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Agenda item 4 is indeed for the committee now to consider whether to accord recognition to the proposed cross-party group wood panel.